cultivate dry ground, water springs. It causes grass and herbs to grow, that man may bring forth food out of the earth.
It is good to look upon the land in the spring, the eager life, the pregnant earth, the straining impatience of a year in its infancy. These are things to stir the heart. This is the time for youth, for young eyes to look upon a young world, a time for inspiration and action, a time for ambition, for a new generation to reach for a new life. It is given to all of us to dream a little, to probe the future for its secrets. For the young in heart, the future is a great uncertainty, a whole life to be dreamed, planned, and lived. But leave a boy with his dreams, and his ambitions take form. That is when he can see himself as a full-grown man, spanning the continent with great iron monsters, threading the skies with power, building a vast new world for tomorrow, or taming the giant steel-making infernos that weld the whole fabric of industry. Yes, the young dream their ambitions. Often their dreams carry them far afield. But opportunity is not chained to distant horizons. It often lies under the hand of the seeker at home. The city of Hamilton is home to much of Canada's industrial empire. Here, the strength, the skill, the minds of many men combine to produce 1,001 products. Goods which have made our age the most productive and the best informed. The great steel industry is the backbone of this industrial giant, basic supplier of the raw material for man's inventive genius. But steel is no simple product. Its forms and qualities are tailored to fit the needs of manufacturers and builders. Behind its simple appearance lies the know-how of chemists, engineers, and furnace men. Men who live and breathe life into the molten, fiery heart of the metal. Our modern civilization is not built upon steel. It is built upon the men who make steel. Across the land, the towering steel skeletons of office, church, and factory overlook a rapidly growing country. In this expansion, the names Pigott, Cope, Frid, and Cooper are signs of progress. For these are builders of a nation. But steel, structural or commercial, cannot stand alone as a symbol of the city's industrial output. The products are as varied as the demands, as skillful as the workmen. Kitchen aids for every convenience. Electrical motors, great and small. Wire, from netting to cable. Glass, radio tubes and lamps. There are grinding wheels designed for industry. And knitted ware designed for commerce. Silverware to please the heart of a bride. And cutlery to furnish her home. But whatever the product, be it food or fabric, these are things of usefulness made by able hands on the shores of Burlington Bay. Whether the goods be mass-produced or made by hand, the trademark is always the same. From blueprint to finished product, the whole industrial harvest bears the imprint of men who live well and work well. And so, to those who look to the future, opportunity is where you make it. Industry has need of all the arts, sciences, and crafts. For men build with heart and mind, as well as muscle. But how do you direct your studies? For what are you best fitted? The answers lie in the schools and institutes which help the beginner to crystallize his personal ambitions. As the home of McMaster University, the Textile Institute, Hamilton College, excellent commercial and technical schools, Hamilton is well fitted to train and supply its own working force. As for personal aptitudes, let us look at a few representative occupations and see what qualifications they demand. The skilled technician is industry's most valuable asset and its most highly sought personality. His thorough knowledge, fine craftsmanship, and inquisitive mind have been developed through years spent in analyzing his special field and its problems. The artisan takes pride in his ability to create. Workers in the arts, photographers, designers, architects, these are people who open the doors to new expressions of taste and value. The machine worker is the Atlas of the production line. On the ability to control precision machinery rests the whole industrial empire. In a machine age, quality is still determined by the accuracy of its human governor. Outdoor personnel, surveyors, railway and construction workers, hydro or telephone linemen, these are men who prefer a wider freedom of activity than a desk will allow. For public utility men, the service offers the benefit of lifetime security. The newcomer to industry is attracted by its infinite variety, the changing spectacle of man creating for his own needs. For industry is the leader in man's climb to the stars, and change is its normal life. Industry sets the pattern, and the world is remade. Did you know that mining is being done close to Hamilton? At Caledonia, a gypsum mine is in full operation. This is a surprising fact for a district usually regarded as a fruit belt. Did you know that auto tires are made flat upon a revolving drum? Did you know that lightning is manufactured by industry? Testing insulators is one of its routine jobs. How is chicken wire twisted and formed? Why are men's socks made in one long length, end to end? How do you heat an axe red hot and keep its cutting edge cold? What is the purpose? Yes, industry is surprising, interesting, profitable. It rewards its working force with a high standard of living by sharing its problems and returns with its personnel. The man who helps to build a better mousetrap also builds a better life. But man does not live by bread alone. He is given to expect more from his daily labor than a roof for his head and food for his children. His work should offer interest as well as a livelihood, opportunity as well as responsibility, and time to play. To Hamiltonians, the playground is Burlington Beach. Under the warm sun, the cares of plant and office soon fade into the deep horizon. But first, in his pursuit of happiness, the worker must find the place to establish his home, a place where the passing of time will give ease to his heart and fulfillment to his dreams. The hard-riding cavaliers who tilt at each other on the Hamilton is built upon courageous men, pioneers who cleared the land, sowed the seed, and brought forth from the black earth great orchards and vineyards. Patriots who fought for their belief.
Foundation of this Canadian nation.
Engineers who gambled to bring electrical power from Niagara. Contractors who dared to pierce the Burlington sand strip to provide an outlet to the Great Lakes. Dreamers who foresaw the strategic position of their city and secured it for future generations. These men were truly cavaliers, and they tilted well. The cavaliers of today are of a different breed. They come from across many seas. Scots, Dutch, French, English, Italian. From whatever land or race they come, the new tongues speak as Canadians. To the nation's culture, these people add stature. In return for their gifts of opportunity and freedom, they offer their customs, their knowledge, and their loyalty. Canada is the beneficiary. Transportation is the vital thread which binds buyer and seller. Without markets, there can be no production. The cycle of trade must be borne by water or rail, road or air. Water. With this great medium, honored as the most ancient means of commerce, Hamilton has sent its products around the earth. Nearby, the Welland Canal, with its impressive flight locks, provides a liquid roadway across the peninsula. This is the lifeline of the continent, the link between the harvesting West and the industrial East. Rail. Hamilton is served by the nation's great railways, the Canadian Pacific, Canadian National, and the Toronto, Hamilton, and Buffalo Railway. Road. As focal point of Southern Ontario's highway network, one of the Dominion's best planned road systems, the city logically acts as an assembly and distribution center. Air. As though road, rail, and water were not enough, the district has within its orbit one of the nation's busiest airports. But a well-balanced community needs more than transportation and commerce to balance its industrial diet. And it is here, in the job of providing relaxation for its citizens, that Hamilton has rounded out its civic life. hand that labors must rest. And within the boundaries of the city itself or the surrounding district, the holiday-minded people can play at all the sports and hobbies which lie closest to their hearts. The young use special rules to measure happiness. It may be the feel of cool water, the freedom of bare feet, or the chance to play games. But however measured, it is a world of noise and action, a world of fun. Few places are blessed with the natural beauty of this city in the garden country of Canada. And it is little wonder that the Cavaliers lay down their burdens at this point, built their homes, and raised their children. When the green foliage carpets the city from the rocky Niagara escarpment to the blue of the bay, Hamilton looks, feels, and becomes home. As you walk along the cool, shaded streets, you see the evidence of a happy people, the gaily colored homes, well-kept hedges, and wide, lawn-bordered avenues. You hear the laughter of children, the carefree sound of young energy given every chance to spread its wings and fly as high as its dreams. You note that religion is not a fetish. The land was given to all the people, and each supplicant, in his own way, pays humble tribute for the gifts received. But the city was born in the fire and cloud of its great industries. It rose on the backs of those who sweated for it. It gained its faith from those who believed in it. And it became great from those who loved it. The torch has been held high. Today, over 500 industries of the metropolis represent Canada's greatest consolidation of manufacturing power. The industrial payroll per week is valued at more than $4 million. The invested American interests are well over $125 million. The faces of industry are many. Scientists, stenographers, engineers, chemists, electricians, men who work with ideas, and men who work with tools. There are builders of equipment and inspectors to test its efficiency. There are craftsmen who create for beauty and craftsmen who create for the common need. These are the faces of opportunity, the character of the future. This is tomorrow for those with eyes to see. Yes, it is good to look upon the land in the spring. It is good to see young minds and hearts tuned to the life around them, receptive to its pulsations, aware of its opportunities. For those who would fulfill their dreams, let them first look to their homeland. Opportunity and fulfillment are greatest where the ties are strongest. Happiness lies on your doorstep.
With faith and fortitude, to lay the foundation of this Canadian nation.